more tied into your mind training and transferring the training, not making any exceptions. So in dealing with people that are really kind of into that, I mean, after Jesus was here during the first century, everyone's like, he's coming back. He's coming back. Yeah. After the second century, he's going to return. And then the third, he will return, you know, and this whole idea started about the second coming of Christ. And this has been going on now for quite a lot of centuries. You know, we still talk to Christians, a lot of Christians, fundamentalist Christians will say, we are entering into the end times. Jesus is coming back. Well, we've been, if you took a recording of all the centuries, people have been waiting for the second coming of Christ. And really, you might say that the second coming of Christ, in the truest sense, will be when you accept yourself as the Christ. You know, that the first coming was like Captain Janeway coming there, a hologram coming and saying, hey, I got good news. But instead of looking for a physical second coming, it's more of like doing your forgiveness work and accepting that you are the living Christ. That's what the message was, you know, was what I have done, you shall do also, and that it's inevitable. And so that takes it out of more of a human linear context of looking for Jesus to reappear. People have said, you know, if Jesus reappeared now, that, you know, he probably wouldn't get accepted by most Christians. He wouldn't fit the box very well. But you might say that that's all still more seen in a personal term, you know, like personal ascended masters and so on and so forth. When the teaching is really, you know, are you willing to let go of this false identity and accept yourself as the living Christ? So that's a whole different way of looking at something like the events that are to come or the second coming of Christ. And I find it very healthy, you know, it's like it starts to eliminate the questions of some of these future events.
Pastor, you see, like, more people, maybe in your travels around the world over the last, was it 18 years or something, you may have seen more and more people now who are awake and living in the happy dream, as opposed to, you know, previously it's like maybe almost a progression or an expansion or more and more people waking up in more and more happy dreams. Is that part of your experience?
It did. I'd say it seemed like my experience. I mean, when I traveled, it just kept opening up like broader horizons and more symbols. And it just kind of led more and more to a point where the whole quantity aspect just completely disappeared. It was like a qualitative experience that had transferred to everyone, so it wouldn't matter. I mean, like in the early years, I was always like going to go to these gatherings, and I was always talking about going deep and going deep and how important it was to go deep. And I just want to be with people where I can go deep and that and that. And then at some point, it just something just clicked where there was no distinctions. I could be in a grocery store, you know, getting some oranges or doing a talk or going out on the Sydney Harbor for a little tour of the harbor, you know, it became stabilized. It didn't have anything to do with quantities, numbers, and you might say the whole, everything just shifted at that point. So, but up to that point, it very much was a sense of more, you know, felt like it was growing stronger and stronger and becoming more witnesses, more places I would go, more happy people, you know, more. It just felt like it was growing in my awareness. And I think people, you know, that was helpful too. That was part of the mind training, you know, that was almost encouraging me to keep at it, you know, because it was going that way. Yeah. Gaze on.
What we put into body is paralysis.
Yeah, I think it's, it can be, it's very important to just follow guidance.